All right, welcome to the Uptime Winergy Podcast. Big week this week, a lot of news on the show.
So we're going to talk about Vestas wind turbine orders dropping in Q2 as compared to last year and why some of the reasons that may be. Also going to visit France to nationalize EDF completely this time.
And Nordex closes its last blade plant in Germany and moves everything to India.
And then we talk about the EU's controversial decision to declare gas and nuclear investments as green.
So in efforts as well for the US to hit 30 gigawatts of offshore wind, we're going to talk about some new concepts in Jones Act compliant vessels that are going to be hopefully built here in the US soon. And then also staying on that same trend of vessels, methanol starting to win the hydrogen shipping race to lower emissions globally for our shipping.
So hold on tight. It's a packed show. We'll be back after the music. All right, guys, Vestas orders and Nordex orders, some really interesting developments there. Vestas publishes every quarter their sales numbers because they're a publicly traded company, and so does Nordex. But Vestas actually describes every single order that they have. It's really interesting on the website. So in Q2 of 2022, this last quarter, they had roughly 1,700 megawatts sold. And that's down quite a bit from where Vestas has been. In Q1, they had 2,900 megawatts sold. And looking back 1 year ago, Vestas had orders of almost 5,300 megawatts. So year on year, like quarter to quarter, Q2 2021 to Q2 2022, their sales are down about 66%. That's a big drop for such a large company. And it seems very odd. Because I know the Vestas sales group is extremely aggressive, and if you watch the news enough, you'll notice that they are everywhere, all across the planet. And one of the key pieces, and I wonder if this is what's driving it, is that only 20% of the orders were in the U.S. About 350 megawatts was in the U.S. And we have seen the onshore wind purchases and agreements in the U.S. are going to plummet. The predictions in 2023 are totally minuscule compared to where we were. And Nordex has a sort of a similar situation. Even though Nordex sales rose a little bit, they sold 1,800 megawatts in Q2 this year versus 1.5 last year. Their distribution of sales is fascinating. Nordex tends to sell mostly in Europe, about 60% to Europe, about 30% in Latin America. That's 90% total. And then the remaining 10% is in North America. So again, North America, I would assume, Joel, it's not Canada, it's mostly the States.
Mm-hmm.
Right, yeah. So they say that Nordex's strongest markets are Germany, Poland, and Spain. And again, United States is not in that mix. So it makes you wonder if some of the problems that the wind turbine companies are having is just that the U.S. market on onshore wind is plummeting. Does that make sense?
I think it does, and I think you can point to PTC. The moonlighting of PTC come December. I mean, you follow the money down. McDonald's can sell as many cheeseburgers as they want, but if the general public doesn't have any cash, you're not going to buy them, right? So if there's not a movement for the developers to want to put money in, and it ties to PTC, if they can't make the money back, if it's not financially feasible, then it's not going to be there.
So PTC ended at the end of 2021, and there's been a lot of projects that got started in 2021 that are running through now, and it'll probably finish in 2023, some of them, right?
Yeah.
And there is a bill in Congress. I was looking this past week. There's a bill in Congress that would extend PTC, but it doesn't look like it's going anywhere, which is really odd. So
the first iteration, I think it was the first iteration of Biden's, like the Biden administration right now, their Build Back Better or whatever. The first iteration had a big chunk of money set aside for PTC. And then there was like some development stuff, kind of like we talked about with the Defense Production Act as well. There was a big chunk of money set aside for it, but all that kind of got, they were, you know, everything's earmarked nowadays. Those earmarks got, the page got torn off when that got passed through. So, yeah, there's some stuff sitting there, but you're not hearing much about it. It was really exciting last... I don't remember when it was. I think it was in December, November, when all that was sitting in the news and it was, oh, that's all this money's going to come into green energy. And then it kind of got melted away. I think that it's a big driver of it, that it's dropping here. Some of it, talking to some of my friends in Europe as well, is the, on the developer side, some of the regulatory environment over there is getting kind of hard to get past, right? There's some very difficult things over there. So as the regulatory environment changes financially down and roadblock up, this is what you see.
Yeah, I kind of wonder if we're mostly tapped out on new wind development, onshore wind development in the States, and it's all going to move, the vast majority of it's going to move offshore, but we're still at least 2 to 3 years away from that. It's just an interesting development to keep our eyes on, and I'm going to watch it as it goes through Q3. And as part of this decline in onshore wind, Nordex is closing its last blade plant in Germany and moving it to India. So it announced it would shut down its Rostock factory in June, and it has about 600 employees. Now, they're going to continue to manufacture nacelles and hubs and drivetrains, but the blades factory, or at least the blade portion of it, could make a maximum, basically rotor diameter of 150 meters. So that's, what is that, 70-odd meter blade, 69 meter blade, something like that, was the limit for the size in that factory. And I guess they figured it's not worth making the investment in Germany. We can open or have a plant in India. It's easier to make bigger blades down in India, and away they went. And Rosemary, is this going to be happening more and more? And is it just the size of the blades that are such a constraint that it makes sense to make them somewhere else?
No, I think it's a bunch of reasons, and it's been happening for a while. Nordex definitely aren't the first. I mean, Enercon has already moved a lot of their manufacturing away from Germany, and LM Wind Power closed down their last real factory in Denmark some time ago. I don't think that there's much manufacturing of blades from other manufacturers in Denmark anymore either. My understanding is it's from two causes. The first is, obviously the cost of labor is can be cheaper in other regions. But I think probably even the more significant thing is where they're selling the blades. And, originally all those German manufacturers were really focused on the German market. And I know Enercon especially was like nearly all of their sales went to Germany. And it seemed to me like there was a big controversy when they were closing down some of their factories because, it was such a major employer in the region where Enercon is based. And so there was like a lot of political intervention to try and get them to stay. And it seemed to me at the time that Enercon had been a bit short-sighted in putting so many eggs in the Germany basket. And I think, in general, German manufacturers, European manufacturers had been really domestic focused. And those that didn't get in early on, expanding outwards and also expanding their manufacturing outwards, suffered when the sentiment around wind in Germany went really jumped off a cliff at one point. Wind energy was like a dirty word in Germany. I haven't been there in a few years, so I don't know how they are feeling now, but in general, people don't want more onshore wind in Germany is what I've noticed. And so if you want to continue making and selling wind turbines, you need to look further afield, and that likely means building the turbines further afield as well.
I got one thought here. Do you think that, so right now we're two and a half years post start of COVID. So when that happened, of course, companies shut down, everybody went home, the world stopped. You had to stare at your loved ones and didn't get to escape them, whichever it was. But do you think that some of this down, how should I explain it? The downfall in orders is tied to the development cycle from that 6 months of when the world kind of shut down. Does that make sense? Does that timeline line up? 2 years ago, all the people that were looking at developing and doing site studies and all this stuff didn't work for 6 months or 9 months. And now we're seeing 2 years later, the residual of that or no?
I don't see that specifically, especially because it's such a long-term trend that started way before COVID. But I think what probably does factor into it is the supply chain issues that were definitely, you know, kickstarted pretty aggressively by COVID and continue now. So I assume that people have to be a bit more picky about which projects they can support now. So I think that that's probably part of it.
One of the interesting pieces of data to pop out in the last week or so is the CO2 emissions over COVID. And I think it was a UN study that I saw this week talking about the different industries and how COVID drove the amount of CO2 emissions. And it's, if you look at different industries like airline versus industry versus residential, you see dramatically different responses. And if you look at it country by country, you see dramatically different responses where China was down a relatively short amount of time and then came back up to more than full capacity. And the rest of the world sort of didn't do that. And we saw big reductions in CO2, almost 10% plus in some cases of CO2 emissions. So there is a drag effect, I think, on Europe from COVID versus China, maybe even in India. What the effect of that's going to be long-term, though, I don't know. I do see, crazily enough, why are we building towers and nacelles and generators in Germany? And the most complex piece, what I would consider the most complex piece, the blades, are going to India. It just seems all backwards. And you got to ship them all the way back. There's a big, huge wind market in India. Everybody agrees with that. And they can do it on the shoreline, which you can put on a ship and go anywhere, I suppose. But it just seems like somehow the math doesn't work out. That's what it seems to me. But I guess we're going to have to just watch it and see where it progresses, because wind isn't going away. It's just a question of where it's shifting to. And speaking of shifting, France is going to nationalize or re-nationalize EDF. And EDF is the big electrical power generator for France, and also is a global player in the renewables market. So France is to renationalize the giant EDF in response to the energy crisis, says its Prime Minister, Elizabeth Borne. Quote, "We must have full control over our electricity production and performance," Borne told Parliament. Now, France already owned 85% of EDF, which is one of the world's largest electricity producers. So they're going to basically by the last 15%. And as Rosemary was describing before we started recording today, there's a lot of problems with an EDF in terms of managing the older equipment, mostly nuclear, I guess, and then building new nuclear and some other projects that are just delayed. So they're in this real crunch where they have older projects that need to get offline or refurbished that are not there. And it's leading to rising electricity rates and a really stressful time already, with electricity prices across the world going up. There's a big concern. If I was a politician in France, I'd be super concerned about it. And they clearly are. But Rosemary, it seems like there's the other side of this is if France is going to nationalize it, one of the things they may not do is stick to their climate goals. In order to lower the price of electricity, especially this upcoming winter, I would expect they're going to get a little bit dirtier to do that. Do you think that's going to happen over the next couple of months?
Yeah, well, I mean, the nationalization is maybe a second issue. I think the really big issue with EDF is just how terribly their reactors have all been performing over the last year or so, and they're projected to get worse in the future. I think currently they've got at less than 50% capacity, just because they had some scheduled maintenance that turned out to be a lot harder than they thought, and it's taking a lot longer. And then they've had some unscheduled maintenance as well. I mean, it's a really aging fleet of nuclear reactors, and I think everybody wants them to take the safety seriously, more seriously than targets. And even I would agree with that the safety of nuclear power plants is the most important thing. I think already we've seen that France's electricity mix probably get less clean because they have to import a lot from elsewhere.
You think they're going to put on more natural gas? They don't really have any coal factories. Like, are they going to add natural gas to the mix just to get them through the winter time?
I'm not sure. They're pretty ideologically committed to nuclear in France, as far as I can tell. Like the politicians, at least. Like I know a lot of French people who are really anti-nuclear, but I think as like if you're to lump everyone together, including the politicians and the people running the energy system over there, I think that they're really committed to nuclear. And I know that they're going to build some more reactors. And obviously. Seems like 10 years ago would have been a better time to start some of those projects because, they've ended up with only really old reactors right now and it takes a long time to get a new one up. But definitely we're starting to see them pulling in, they're connected to the rest of Europe. So they're pulling in energy from other sources to fill the gaps. And it is probably getting more dirty because France's grid is quite clean, relatively speaking, because they've got so much nuclear. There's not a lot of emissions from nuclear. Whether we want to call that clean or green or whatever, that's a topic for, I think, a little bit later in the episode. But
glowing, maybe? Glowing energy?
Yeah, fluorescent, fluorescent green. But I think definitely it's getting more expensive. That like if you look at the price that people are paying in France, it's high because they're relying on grabbing it from other markets who are also struggling with maybe not shortfalls, but definitely they're feeling the pinch. So it's not an ideal situation for them to be in.
Yeah, let alone bringing those gas plants online. The gas pinch over there and all of Europe is feeling that.
Yeah, building new gas power plants doesn't seem like a ticket to cheap energy prices right now, does it?
No.
There really is no cheap energy right now, right? The 6 months ago, a year ago, there was all kinds of cheap energy around it, and everything has skyrocketed up and it doesn't look like it's price stabilized. It is coming down a little bit over the last couple of weeks, but it hasn't price stabilized yet. There's more turmoil to come, and when the demand gets high, which is going to be in the wintertime, then we're really going to be in some interesting times. Because it feels like the world is sort of destabilized in the last 6 weeks, weirdly enough. It has this sort of 1980s feel to it all of a sudden. And you guys may not have been alive or cognizant back then, but I sure was. And it definitely has that feel of Europe is in a little bit of turmoil right now, and that usually means America is going to be in turmoil with it. We'll see how it plays out, but I think there's going to be a lot of close connections between the United States and Europe, and this latest thing from the EU Parliament is really going to kick that off nicely. So we're going to take a quick break right here, and when we get back, we're going to have Rosemary. I'm going to set the soccer ball, the cricket ball, whatever they use in Australia for Rosemary to kick or throw at. Because we'll talk about EU Parliament, and they decided that gas and nuclear are green investments. So we'll be right back.
Get the latest on wind industry news, business, and technology sent straight to you every week. Sign up for the UPTIME Tech Newsletter at weatherguardwind.com/news.
All right, we're back, Rosemary. And here we go. The EU Parliament this week declares gas and nuclear investments as green. So there's a couple of votes in the EU Parliament, and this is a preliminary vote. I don't think this is the final vote yet. They still have a little bit to go, but it looks like it's being greenlit, so to speak, this new proposal. So the new rules will add natural gas and nuclear power plants to the EU taxonomy rulebook from 2023, which enables investors to label and market investments as green. So you can have your LNG power plant have the green label on it. And this is causing a lot of consternation. So there's a huge debate about it in Europe and the rest of the world, by the way. I saw Greta Thunberg tweet about it. Pretty much anybody on the environmental side is really upset with this. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, lots of thoughts. So, I mean, I guess the first thing is, does it matter, if people can call it a green investment? It's kind of a, such a a vague term anyway, isn't it? Green. So I'm not sure the actual implications of it. That doesn't sound to me like they're, you know, getting European funding to build gas plants under, you know, instead of that money going to a wind farm or a solar farm or a battery project. So maybe it's not such a huge deal. But certainly, I mean, on the face of it, it's just absolutely ridiculous to call gas a green investment. I mean, there's a lot of emissions from gas, and it seems like every week there's a new study that shows that methane leakage from the, you know, gas supply chain is much worse than thought. And, you know, methane is such a potent greenhouse gas. It's, you know, 20 to 100 times more, has more warming impact than carbon dioxide, and the hit is really early with methane. So, you know, given that we're trying to, you know, really pull down, you know, emissions as fast as possible, it makes sense to be going hard on getting rid of methane, not expanding it. So it's confusing in that sense, and I just can't understand why we even need a bunch of European politicians or bureaucrats to decide what's a green investment or not, because shouldn't you just have like an emissions intensity and that tells you whether it's green or not? You know, they should have just set a number that, you know, below this, that's a green investment, and above it, it's not. So, you know, I don't have a real problem with nuclear being on the list because, you know, it doesn't cause a lot of emissions. And I also don't have a problem with gas being seen as an enabling technology for the energy transition. And I mean, emphasis on the transition part of that, because it is such a flexible technology. So it can really nicely support the rollout of more renewables without causing, you know, blackouts and, making things smoother while we figure out how bad Dunkelflautes are we going to get, you know, like when there's a period with no wind and no sun. You can kind of like look at the, is that not a term you've heard before, Alan? You look confused.
I have no idea what that word was.
Dunkelflaute.
You need a syllable.
You need to add it to your vocabulary. It's one of those fantastic German words where, you know, it's one word, but it describes a whole concept. So it's a concept of when there's no wind and no sun, and the literal English translation would be something like the dark lull or dark doldrums, people sometimes call it. That's at the moment, that's kind of like a thing a lot of people have in their mind, a big fear. You can look at the statistics of climate statistics, you know, in the past, and have a sense of how often this is going to happen. But I think this is going to be one of the biggest challenges of moving to an all variable renewables grid. And if we have some gas left in the system, then that will help you, you know, ride through any Dunkelflautes that we experience before we've totally figured out this, you know, variable renewables grid. So, I think it's good to keep gas in the system and keep that flexibility there. It makes the rest of the energy transition much, much easier. So, you know, I'm a bit different to some of the climate activists like Greta Thunberg and Greenpeace and, you know, all these people that have that are just 100% opposed to gas. I don't see it that way, but I wish we would just focus on the emissions intensity.
And nuclear.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a problem with nuclear if people think that it's, you know, going to be fast enough and cheap enough to, you know, way to add clean generation to their mix, then go for it. But
won't this open up investment money for nuclear in a sense? It sounds like this is a tax thing, right? So if it reduces the tax burden on investments into nuclear, wouldn't you think it would at least spur more development in Europe for nuclear? Because there hasn't been a lot of huge advancements in nuclear reactors in 50 odd years. There's talks of about generation 4 and the new technology, recycling the previously used radioactive material and these new generators. All that discussion happens, but there hasn't been any action on it. Does this now crack that open and say, okay, let's look at nuclear like France has been?
Yeah, I think there's a really big price difference is the reason why we haven't seen a lot of new nuclear projects, especially not ones that are unsubsidized substantially by governments. And I've got no problem if, that we make developing nuclear a little bit more attractive. It is a, you know, it's a low emissions technology, and I'm happy to see more of it where people want it around.
What is it? Do you know, so, Rosemary? Joel, I was gonna say, do you know just off the top of your head? And this is just a curiosity point, but like per megawatt, how does nuclear compare to wind for a new installation? Is it an order of magnitude, or is it two or three times? Or
I mean, it's pretty clean, right? There's no, you don't get carbon dioxide when the nuclear reaction happens. So it's similar to renewables in the sense that the emissions come from the supply chain, basically. And right. I guess also there's, right. you know, some processing of nuclear waste as well, right. that would have some emissions. But yeah, I mean, yeah. to me, it's roughly similar. I wouldn't call it renewable because it's not renewable, but I'm happy to call it clean.
Yeah, I guess what I'm thinking is the cost of new installations. Is the cost of new installations,
is it
two or three times?
Oh, the, let me look
or
up
is
the
it
chart.
A more order of magnitude?
I did a video on it. You can check out my video on levelized cost of energy. All right, so I looked up the latest Lazard levelized cost of energy comparisons. That's version 14. And they've got nuclear is, for new build nuclear, it's between $129 and $198 per megawatt hour.
Megawatt.
Yeah, and wow. then solar, depending on the kind, is between 29 to 42 for utility scale, and a bit right. higher for other kinds. And then wind, they haven't actually got it separated off into on and offshore yet in this version. It's between 26 and 54. So yeah, it's not an order of magnitude, but it's a lot different.
Four or five times, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, double.
Yeah, oh, yeah, yeah, way yeah. more than
offshore wind. Double. Yeah, the LCOE of offshore wind is pretty high.
Oh yeah, actually, I think right you do have it $86 yeah. for offshore. Maybe that's what that point is.
Yeah, it's fairly high. So that would make sense. So nuclear is probably the most expensive of
yeah,
all.
Yeah, there's not even any overlap between offshore and nuclear. But for existing nuclear that's already depreciated, then that's they've got $29 right. for that. So that is competitive.
So key then, keeping the plants open that you have? Well, I mean, Germany keeps talking about closing plants. I know France is trying to refurbish plants. In the United States, we're closing plants. Is the key to keep the energy prices low, is to keep those running?
Yeah, but it's not.
They just did that in California, I think. Newsom came back and was like, this nuclear plant we were going to close, now we're going to keep it back online because they have to.
I think they have
yeah,
to.
Yeah, it's not easy for Germany, though, because that was something that I was going on about early in this gas price crisis was, you know, why is Germany closing their nuclear power plants? They should stop it. But it's not easy for them to do that because they have known for, you know, like 10 years plus that they're going to be phasing out, closing them around now. There's a lot of maintenance that didn't happen, safety checks that didn't happen over the last decade that would need to be done now if they were going to keep it open. So mm-hmm. it's not like mm-hmm. you can't just say, okay, we're going to close it in 6 months and we won't now. It would be like, okay, in 6 months, we'll launch a 2-year campaign to make sure that this thing is still safe to run, to continue. And by then, you know, you could probably actually have a bunch of extra wind and solar and transmissions projects in the ground. So, yeah, I think in Germany's case, it's, if it happened, you know, 5 years ago, they may well have made that decision, but I understand that it's too late now for Germany to just decide to extend the operation.
Oh, come on.
I mean, no one wants to see someone just, you know, like, we didn't check the safety of this nuclear power plant, but we assume it's okay.
Let it run. Hey, man, that happens
Homer
in wind.
Simpson at the console.
Yeah, that happens in wind all the time, right? Like we as at Wind Power Lab, we've looked yes. at some, you know, for due diligence for M&A stuff, people buying wind farms, and the people who owned them before were like, well, they're going to go decommission, 2022. So for the last 7 years, we didn't touch the blades. And now a new person's going to buy them and it's like, whoa, look at these blades. It looks like nobody's on any maintenance. They haven't. They decided not to. It was better for ROI to say, we're going to take them down in 2022. But now you want them? It's going to be a pretty penny to get those things back up and running smoothly.
But as Rosemary always says, it's relative to what, right? And if refurbing or re-inspecting doing the maintenance on an existing nuclear facility has got to be less money than building new. Has to be.
But it's not just the money, it's the,
so
it's the time.
It makes sense to do that.
As well. It's the time that it takes for that. Yeah. So it's not actually a solution to the current crisis because it's still going to be years before you can actually take advantage of this, you know, lifetime extension of your nuclear power plant.
Asset.
But if you declare gas as being green, that gives you the time to
do that. Well, it turns out that solving climate change is really easy. If all you got to do is just say gas is green now, petrol, gasoline cars are green now.
Problem solved.
747s are green now. That's all you need to do. Just designate
that. Just fix the energy
exactly,
problem.
Exactly. Designate it all green and we've made so much progress. Wow.
Lightning is an act of God, but lightning damage is not. Actually, is very predictable and very preventable. Strike Tape is a lightning protection system upgrade for wind turbines made by WeatherGuard. It dramatically improves the effectiveness of the factory LPS so you can stop worrying about lightning damage. Visit weatherguardwind.com to learn more, read a case study, and schedule a call today.
All right, there is a group down in Houston, a startup, basically, called Bleutec Industries, and I'll spell it out because it's not like you would assume it is. And I've seen it spelled two different ways, actually. Bleutec Industries, and there's no H on the end. And their CEO, Robin Botman, is discussing about offshore wind turbine installation vehicles and how there really is no existing Jones Act compliant vessels. And if you're going to start from scratch, how would you design these offshore wind turbine support vessels? What would you do? And so they have announced what they call the Binary Marine Installation Solutions, BMIS, which is a very odd acronym, but okay, which has been developed in cooperation with NESCO, Naval Architecture, and Marine Engineering, and Netherlands-based heavy lift expert Penthus. And it's a self-propelled jackup vessel with a dual crane setup that is supposedly cheaper, faster, you know, does all the good things at building and installing monopiles. So that basically it's a monopile focused ship. So you drive the monopile on the ground and then you move on to the next one. So it's very reduced in terms of what it does, but it does one job really well. So there's actually two pieces of this. This is the binary part. There's a piling installation vessel and a wind turbine installation vessel light, they're calling it. So it's a small version. And then those two pieces are coupled with, it sounds like there's support equipment and SOVs that, you know, feed all the people who are working on these vessels. But they're talking about, Joel, they're talking about a really short timeline. Like the piling installation vessel is possibly available in the third quarter of 2024. So they got about 2 years to put that together. And the wind turbine installation vehicle, they're talking about the third quarter of 2025. And you have to start cutting steel like now.
Yeah.
To get this, to get this in the water, right?
Absolutely. So there's a couple of schools of thought here, right? When the offshore industry started blowing up in Northern Europe, it was, first off, repurposing old oil and gas vessels to do the things, right? Like, oh, we have this nice here, we can use this. And I mean, I saw tenders flying when I was in the oil and gas world. We saw a lot of tenders flying across for novel sensor technology and camera vision systems and inertial measurement units to try to drive these piles perfectly straight off the side of these vessels. Because that's a huge problem, right? The verticality of that pile is key to the structural stability of the whole set asset. So that was an issue, right? And then building these vessels was an issue. So it looks like this company has taken, you know, 10, 20, 30 years of watching or dissecting the issues that happened in offshore wind in Northern Europe and have kind of developed solutions to solve all of those things by having this team of vessels that works together. So I like that. There is also, you know, another thought of, man, we need these vessels now, and you're totally reinventing the wheel. So if you're reinventing the wheel, but part of it is you're going to be able to build them faster to 2024, that's great. Because I know I have seen some of the timelines of these other vessels that they're like, oh, we're going to come over and build this one, the same design. And they're like, oh, yeah, it'll be there by 2026. It'll be there by 2027.
7, 8. Yeah,
exactly. So, and if we're going to have 30 gigawatts in the water by 2030, we better get these vessels out quicker than that. So, you know, we did see last week a couple of the development companies and asset owners in the offshore world write a letter to our government saying, help with the Jones Act, please, because otherwise we just won't be able to do anything. So maybe this is someone will come along and invest a heavy sum into these things to get them built because they'll be Jones Act compliant. They'll have to be built here in the U.S., right? It doesn't go as far as saying you have to get all the steel here, so some of the steel will come from wherever, but... So if they can build them quick and the design works, fantastic. That'll help out our offshore wind in the U.S. In a massive way. It's a little bit brand new, right? So I hope they've thought through all the issues and they're not creating new ones.
Well, the weird thing was on LinkedIn when I saw this article pop up, and there's a bunch of people on LinkedIn discussing this, was a couple of comments like, hey, there are available vessels for sale right now that could do that same job. And I thought, well, that's interesting. And sure enough, there are websites that are selling installation vessels, basically big flat bottomed ships with cranes on them.
Yeah.
They're just workships, right? Exactly. And they're sitting dry dock. And if you like to own one, it wouldn't take all that much money to get a hold of one and move it to where you are. That's a really weird thing. You wouldn't think to be an eBay for ships, but there's actually a used ship market, like buying a used car.
Oh yeah.
And so why hasn't anybody done that? Is it because these wind turbines are growing so fast, Rosemary, that the wind turbines are growing faster than the ships can possibly be built? Is that what's happened?
I've got no idea, to be honest.
So here's another thought for you. So like I'm comfortable going and buying a 2-year-old Chevy truck that a Chevy mechanic has gone through. Yeah. I'm not comfortable buying a 15-year-old dirt bike that I have no idea who's owned it and the top end might be blown up and all these other things, right? Because that Chevy truck, I know what it's going to do. I know how it's going to work. I know all these things.
Right.
And the majority of the ships and the secondhand market, they've been cold stacked. They've been, you know, the people went out of business and they just let them rot. All the hoses are jacked up. They don't. Because I've seen it in the oil and gas world where someone's like, hey, guys, we picked up this vessel for cheap over in Ghana and we're going to go and run this thing out of it. And you get out there and vessel downtime is 80%. It doesn't work, right? And then you're again on the same roll. None of those vessels were built for. There's ships that can technically do it, right? But none of those vessels were built for offshore wind installation. All right, driving these monopiles is a very specialized operation that would take a lot of changing those vessels over, and if the hulls aren't designed for the right stability with all that kind of craneage on them, and it just doesn't work.
Well, it's going to be a real conflict, right? We're coming to the point where somebody's got to start cutting steel on some ship, otherwise 2030 is going to go by the wayside. Am I wrong about that? I don't think so. They got to do something like now.
Yeah, there's some players that are making moves, but I think it's more in the logistics side of things, because logistics are easier, right? It's easier to get a big old workboat and throw turbines on it and move them around. But the actual monopile pounding ships and stuff, that's specialized vessels. So I know there's some guys in Louisiana starting to work on some, but I don't know to what scale.
Well, you think the Gulf would be easier. Maybe not. Maybe be worse.
But the shipbuilding prowess down in the Gulf for workboats, because of all the offshore oil and gas down there, is top quality.
And how long does it normally take to build a ship?
Well, I mean, you can put together like a... So have you seen the SVAC boats? The SVAC boats in the North Sea, and they're nice, beautiful, big red ships with the curved front ends and all this stuff on them, and they're awesome. I think they're actually a Norwegian design, even though it's a Danish company. But those are fantastic. But those take forever to build because all the steel is bent and moved, and so that one of those vessels can take 2 years to build. But if you're just building a workboat, like, say, Schwest Marine out of Houma, Louisiana, or the Borderland Group down there, they've been building these things. They'll pound one of those together in 6 months.
Mm. Wow.
But it won't be that pretty, nice, big, fancy, cool hull design, right? It'll be big flat bottom boat with a couple of big old diesels on it and a cab up front, and here we go.
So maybe it's just a little bit.
Yeah, it'd be built American style.
Nothing wrong with that.
Can you barbecue on the back? Yeah, can you barbecue on the back deck? Set her loose.
Dang straight.
Yeah.
Yeah, so maybe it is actually early for, you know, maybe no one's building these ships now because it's a little bit early for them to actually be able to, you know, make some money from it. I think that there's other, you know, there's a lot of other pieces that have to come into play for these, you know, before you're ready to actually start, you know, sticking foundations in the ground or in the seafloor.
Yeah, I mean, you'd be better off. If I was a developer right now, I would do what they did on Block Island, and I'd be putting jackets out, because jacket installation vessels exist in the Gulf right now that have been there forever, because that's how they do oil and gas. The monopile pounding ones are the odd ones.
Okay. It's a really interesting topic. I should make a video.
Well, Rosemary.
anyone listening? Yeah, anyone listening who's got a related company and wants to give me access to get some good video footage of this, I think that would be a cool topic to show how offshore wind farm installation happens. That would be cool.
Well, you should also do a video on what we're going to talk about next, which is methanol is winning the hydrogen shipping race. And so ammonia has been talked about as being derived from green hydrogen and as a fuel to power ships, right? It's what's the chemical? It's NH4, right? Ammonia, or is it NH3? Did I add a hydrogen onto it?
NH3 for ammonia.
Okay. Okay. So NH3. So you can make ammonia, which is a liquid. It's a liquid fuel, right? It's got hydrogen in it. So it's not a hydrocarbon, but it has hydrogen, which you can strip off and then use as a fuel. And it's been talked about for powering ships. And also liquid hydrogen has also been talked about for powering ships. The problem with liquid hydrogen is it's got to be really, really, really cold. The problem with ammonia is that it's toxic. Okay, so there's a big discussion among shipbuilders and ship operators, like, what's the fuel of the future? Because the global shipping industry is responsible for about 3% of the global greenhouse gas emissions at the moment. So they're looking for carbon neutral alternatives. And ammonia has been one of those discussed for quite a while. But it looks like because of the issues with ammonia and liquid hydrogen that we're going to be moving to methanol, basically green methanol. Now, I'm putting green in quotations. You can't hear this on a podcast, but I've got quotations up. It's green methanol. And a lot of shipping companies are already moving this direction. I guess
I think you said it pretty good.
Rosemary?
Yeah, your first attempt was,
wow, okay,
was fine, I think, for an English interpretation of
good,
it.
Good work.
Which is all we can aim for.
there we go.
All we can aim for.
Well, you know, we don't shoot too high here in America. So the Maersk is already is expressing a preference for methanol, which is, I do know, CH3OH. Take that, Rosemary. which is produced by combining hydrogen with captured carbon dioxide. So you can make this complicated methanol molecule. So methanol is far less toxic. And as we've seen on some recent YouTube videos, and it's probably been on TikTok where you've seen ammonia leaks, and if you Google that, it's surprising how many ammonia leaks there are every day in the world. I was looking at one from a chicken factory. So it's pretty toxic, and so if you have an ammonia leak, it's a problem. And on ships, I guess leaks are very common. Rosemary, does this make sense to you? Is there such a thing as green methanol? And are we going to use electricity to create green hydrogen and turn it into methanol so that we can then power the ships? Is that where we're
headed? Yeah, it's not really zero carbon to, you know, take CO2 out of the atmosphere and then, well, I guess if you're taking it out of the atmosphere, then you are kind of, you know, getting an extra loop with the carbon, because it is just going, you burn methanol and you're still going to get that CO2 back in the atmosphere.
Sure.
And especially if you're capturing it from a fossil fuel power plant, for example, then it's a stretch to call that zero emissions. But yeah, definitely methanol has the advantage over ammonia that it's not toxic, and it's already, you know, used as a fuel. It's something that we know pretty well, so that's fine. And it has the advantage over hydrogen that, like you mentioned, that hydrogen is, you have to liquefy it, or it takes up a lot less space if you liquefy it to transport it, but then you have the problem that hydrogen boils at such a low temperature that you get boil off if you try and, you know, transport liquid hydrogen for a long amount of time, I guess. But both ammonia and methanol have the problem that you have to do an extra, you know, if you're starting with hydrogen and then you have to convert it first to methanol or ammonia, you know, there's some losses in that. A lot of the times when people talk about, we'll transport hydrogen as methanol or as ammonia, they're not just talking about converting it to those chemicals. They're also talking about converting it back to hydrogen at the end, and then you get, you know, an extra inefficiency. So, as long as people are using it as methanol, as a fuel, that's a lot better. And as long as it's for something that couldn't be done with something else, really. So shipping is definitely one of the tricky things to know what's going to work out. There's heaps of ways that you can, power a ship in a green way. But the current fuel that we use for shipping is just so, so, so cheap. It's like literally the bottom of the barrel, right? It's, it's stuff that no...
That's where it comes from, too.
Yeah, exactly. No one wants it for anything else. It's very cheap. And so... anything green that I have heard of is going to, make shipping a lot more expensive. So my kind of conclusion on shipping is that it's going to be one of those things where we are going to be doing a lot less of it once it goes green. And I think that will happen naturally, because I think like a huge proportion of the world's shipping is to ship fossil fuels. So obviously we won't need that. And then I think also we're going to see more like... onshoring of manufacturing. So, like Australia just ships heaps of dirt to rocks to China for processing. So instead of shipping iron ore, we might ship steel. And instead of shipping... What do you mean? That's how Australia works. That's how our economy works. Like,
you're shipping rocks to China? Why are you shipping rocks to China? That seems like the most ridiculous thing to ship.
To them rocks? As in the form of iron ore, so that they can process that into steel. And we ship lithium. It's rocks. We crush it up. So maybe it's not rocks anymore. Maybe it's gravel. And then we ship that, and then they process it. And I mean, I'm not so intimately involved with what other countries are doing, but if a lot of processing happens in China, that's because they're getting the raw materials. Anything that's not from China, they're getting the raw materials. And in mining, you're not seeing concentrations of 50-60%. It's sometimes for some things you concentrations of 1% or lower in the case of some of the really rare stuff or scarce stuff. So it's huge volumes that get shipped. And I think that there's big savings to be made by more onshoring of processing, especially in Australia, where we have plenty of energy to do it. Time out.
That's what my question is. Why isn't, if China's going to do that, why wouldn't China just build the factories in Australia with all the renewable wind and solar that are in Australia? That makes zero sense to move the rock. Am I crazy?
But it's just follow the money. It is for the answer. It's not just the money. It's also the environmental impact as well. Because some of these processes can be done much more cheaply if you're not as concerned about environmental regulations. So that makes it more expensive, more energy intensive to do it in a country like Australia or the US than in a country like China. And it's going to be a huge shift over the next few years. Everyone's talking about it now. But we can't just bring the lithium processing, the rare earth processing into Australia or the US and do it the same way that China is and the way that they're getting their really cheap prices, because that would be unacceptable environmental consequences for us. So we've traded off. China has gotten a strategic advantage and sewn up the market on many or most of these critical minerals. And the trade-off has been we've gotten cheap cheap critical minerals, but we don't have the supply chain security. And we also have basically just offshored the environmental problem. So if we want to re-onshore it, then we have to accept it's going to cost more because you've got to take care of the environment. You can't have radioactive waste flowing into rivers. And there's a whole suite of other problems if you just do things in the cheapest way possible. So anyway, that's a bit of a tangent from...
So then it is pretty critical.
From shipping. But
No, it just tells you how critical it is that the shipping industry tries to find a renewable source of fuel for the ships, right? And that's the reason why, because you're moving rocks around, of all things. One of the interesting pieces is Maersk, Germany's MPCC, and France's CMA CGM have already ordered 26 methanol dual fuel vessels between them. So they can burn the existing sort of low quality diesel fuel and methanol because they're preparing to having to switch over. And I'm guessing in some parts of the world they use methanol, in some other parts of the world they will not use methanol, but they need to have the option to use both. Now, and that's, if you're buying 26 vessels that are built that way, that's a lot of cash you're putting down, and you're betting on methanol being the future. So that essentially wipes out ammonia. It's going to essentially wipe out hydrogen because the big shippers have already made the decision in terms of the shipping. If Maersk is making that kind of move, what's everybody else going to do? They're going to follow that lead, I would assume.
The dual fuel nature of methanol and fuel oil or diesel has been around for a long time. Right. So if you're ever at a gas station, and this you can't do this in other countries, but in the U.S., if you're ever at a gas station and you see someone taking jugs, 3, 4, 5 jugs of windshield wiper fluid and putting them in the back of a tank in a pickup truck, that's a methanol injection kit into a diesel engine. It'll make the diesel engine, it'll run on diesel, but it will go from like 20 miles a gallon to about 25 miles a gallon and increase the horsepower by about 200 horsepower.
Well, there you go. They've taken the...
windshield wiper fluid.
They've taken the American ingenuity. And they're applying it to huge, expensive ships. Well, there you go. Well, hey, some of the best inventions start at the simplest ideas, and maybe that's one of them. That's good. It's good to see. So there's just a lot of interesting news this weekend. We didn't even get to talk about Boris Johnson stepping down. So we'll talk about that next week. But it's been a crazy, crazy last 48 hours. Well, that's going to do it for this week's Uptime Wind Energy Podcast. Thanks for listening. Be sure to subscribe in the show notes below to the Uptime Tech News, our weekly newsletter, as well as Rosemary's YouTube channel, Engineering with Rosie. And we'll see you next week on the Uptime Wind Energy Podcast.